Since the December 2020 launch of the Constitutional Force Majeure and the escalation of debates around the agitations in the land, the grievances that have led to demand for independence and self-determination, of course, all kinds of questions have now come to the arena, especially around the constitution in question, the constitution 1999. Many people are asking, what is it about this constitution that connects with everything that, you know, whether it's the killings that are happening to them or their assets that are detained, or all kinds of the security that has broken down all around them, and the hopelessness pervading the poverty that has swallowed the land. Nigeria is now the world poverty capital. 2 days ago, Nigeria became the country with the highest number of unemployed persons, and all of that. So all such negative things. People are asking, what are those things in that constitution? That, because at every turn, we say, it is the constitution 1999. What is the solution to the problem? It is taking down that constitution. So we've come now to provide some general answers to some of those inquiries, particularly the specific provisions, so that people can see that there are provisions in that constitution directly responsible for the shackles on their legs, the manacles on their hands, and all of what has brought about all the things they are talking about. So let's take it from the preamble and go all the way down to the end where you find the exclusive list, so that for every part they can see what is it that is responsible for what they want to escape from, to now realize that it is the taking down of that constitution that is the beginning of the solution to their problem, whether they want out of the union entirely or they want autonomy to a certain degree, which is not present at this time, or they want just good governance, whatever, or end to corruption. Whatever it is you want different from what we are seeing, the starting point is to help now take down that constitution. The preamble, for instance, is where the question of our sovereignty, how Nigeria took over our lands and called it Nigeria and refusing to talk with us. The preamble that says we, the people, have solemnly resolved to live in unity as one indivisible country called Nigeria is like the memo of a company. You know the memo and article, because the preamble, the constitution to the country is like the memo and article to the company. The memo creates the company. That's where Johnson, Jude, and Jeremiah come together to form John Jude Limited. The articles is where the relationship between those three as the owners of the company are defined. Who brings what? Who takes what? How will new people join them? How will they exit? How will they treat their profits or their debts? And how do they wind up or branch into other businesses? Everything they have to do as the owners of that company is what you find in the articles. In the same way, the constitution sets out the general agreement of how we become the union. And so that preamble that says we the people means we the Ijaw, we the Ogoni, we the Fulani, we the Chief, having solemnly resolved, it means that is the point at which we submit our lands and our people into the union. Then it comes to the closing part in that same preamble to say, do hereby make and give unto ourselves the following constitution. That is now the articles. Who is going to be governor? Who is going to be senator? What tenure? Who is going to control what in that union of Nigeria? Assets, citizenship, right of this and left of that. And so it is that preamble. It is that preamble that make you Nigerian. It is that preamble that brings your land, that brings your land into the union of death called Nigeria. And that is your signature right there, authorizing your own damnation. Everything you complain about in the rest of the constitution, whether it is the 36 states into which the four regions were now fractured, or the seizure of the assets of those regions by the federal government, now compiled in those 68 items of exclusive list, or the corruption provision, the provisions that fuel corruption, that authorize corruption, and give immunity to the beneficiaries of corruption, or the infrastructural decay that is occasioned by the fact that those who are in need of the infrastructure are forbidden by that constitution from building them. In all of it, everything that has gone wrong that is now responsible for all these outcomes we are seeing, flow from that authorization from you, that is how you want to live. If you want to understand how that preamble affects everything, just add to it that it is a lie that we, the people, have resolved to live together. If you add those words, it is a lie, you will then see the full meaning. Then you come down to the do hereby make, you see also say, it is also a lie that we make and give unto ourselves the following constitution. And that preamble applies to every single provision of that constitution. If you want to know the gravity of it, you come to oil and gas that is on the exclusive list, for instance. You take that preamble to say, we, the Ijaw people, have solemnly resolved to live with the Fulani in this manner, such that this oil and gas, we also hereby accept that the oil and gas will belong to the Gawa people. That is what that preamble applies. You come to the appropriation provision that give the spare key to the president and the governors, the spare key to the treasury. You again bring the preamble to say, we have all agreed that this president should have the spare key to the treasury. We have all agreed that this governor should have the spare key to the treasury. You come to 308, you say, we have all agreed that those who are in control of this treasury should not be accountable to us. Even if they kill us, well, we have to endure it. That is, that preamble applies to, we have all agreed that we will live in a formation of 36 states in which the federal government can be in charge of everything. We have all agreed, that's exclusively. We have all agreed to be in 74 local government areas in which Kano can have 44 units and Bayelsa have 8 units, with all its implications for representation at the National Assembly and resource allocation. So when you hear about preamble, that is the point at which your signature has been put on a document that took all your assets. So when we invite you to come and join in taking that damn constitution, we're inviting you to come to retrieve your signature so that you can retrieve your sovereignty. It is that preamble that sees your sovereignty. Then you come to the next one of the formations in which we live, the 36 states, the 7 of all local governments areas, because they are all listed in those first few sections of the constitution. You come to Section 6C, that says that nullifies the whole of your benefit as citizens, listed in Chapter 2. Every good thing that is your own share of the social contract. The constitution is the social contract. There were things you looked forward to in submitting your sovereignty to a bigger union so that you can get security, you can get welfare, you can get equal treatment in that union. You can get all the things that are supposed to be for the citizen, healthcare, school system. Section 6, subsection 6C, nullifies it because it makes it discretionary to those in government. It says they can do only at their own, only as is convenient for them. So you do not have a legal recourse against them if they don't do. And so, bottom line, the government does not owe you any obligation. Everything listed for you is put at their discretion. If they don't do it, well, you only go and cry in your closet. If they do it, you have to kneel down and thank them. They are doing it out of make of human kindness, going by that. You come to Section 6, Subsection 6D. There's a period of 33 years listed from 15th of January 1966 to the 29th of May in 1999. 33 years of immunity. All atrocities committed by people who govern Nigeria, particularly in the military era, everything they did in that period to hijack everybody's assets that have now become oil blocks from Niger Delta or some of the big farms we have around today, including the one in Otta. It is Land Use Act that they use to take everybody's assets. Petroleum Act, we see people going to stand around in Abuja now talking about petroleum industry bill. You know, all those things that were done by which these assets, economic assets, were confiscated and shared as allocations. That's how Dangote is in control of half of the port of Lagos. That's how Atiku through Intel is in control of half of the port in Port Harcourt. Allocations, all kinds of things. Everything done in that period, Section 6, Subsection 60, grants immunity to the beneficiaries. See, the jurisdiction of the court does not extend to looking into whatever happened in that period. That is the foundation of the impunity we complain about today, because the beneficiaries of the atrocities of that period are richer than many governments across the world today. But we cannot probe. Even people who killed their neighbors to take the assets, the children are still alive, seeing those assets, they say you can't look at it. The courts cannot listen to you when you come. Those are the things. And you go from there to the appropriation provisions that in Section 81 says the president should go to get authorization for expenditure from the Treasury, from National Assembly. And Section 82 that allows him to go running government, spending money. Every money you find in the Treasury can be taken out through the loopholes created in that very provision. The president can take everything he finds in the Treasury for any purpose. National Assembly will not be able, because it says subject to 50%, that is subject to what was approved the year before. So the president just put a bogus figure. That is what you see Ghana must go, that happens at appropriation. They put a bogus figure and take 50% of it. Any amount you find in the Treasury that comes under 50%, they can take without recourse to anybody. I want young people to confront lawyers, the senior advocates, the professors of law, wherever you find them. These are specific provisions that are responsible for the things happening to everybody. The corruption we see is because that spare key was provided for the heads of the executive branch deliberately to facilitate their access to the Treasury to take out all the money. And then you come to Section 308 that gives immunity. You can't question them for whatever they do while in office, whether they're beheading everybody or they're cutting away all the contents of the Treasury. These are all the things that have worked together to bring us to where we are. We have other things that are embedded in that constitution that are also responsible for certain things that people cannot... We've seen quota system and how it works. They say federal character. And then you bring your worst, you preserve the choices of places, whether it's in school or at openings for work, you preserve for your worst, capable people, and then the best ones are kicked out by that mechanism. We come to NYSC that have been embedded in that constitution since it first came. Let us look at this map. The NYSC, we are told, was a scheme to get the young people to go and interact and know themselves. We came through a war. Instead of going to resolve the issues that led to the war, you leave the issues unresolved and you say, oh, if young people can go and interact among themselves, the troubles will go away. Look at this map. The purpose of NYSC is to draft the children of Port Harcourt, the children of Warri, the children of Lagos, the children of Ibadan, to go and perish in Kaurandamoda, Potiskum, Bill, Gashua, and also to bring the children of Sokoto and Kano and Maiduguri. Look at this map. To go to Port Harcourt and Lagos, where they'll be absorbed in NNPC, in Central Bank, in NPA. 90% of the bureaucracy running Nigeria today, the recruitment came from that dubious process. And that is why they put that NYSC decree into that constitution. Nobody can touch it. You require what the highest level of majority to be able to touch Land Use Act and NYSC Act. So in all of it, the entire thing is a fraud through and through. You come down to the question of even the one that people say school certificate, to tell you that everything is a scam. They tell you one thing. It is the opposite that you find when you go to look. School certificate that you thought was a WAEC and GCE and teacher's grade 2, no. School certificate is defined in Section 318 along with many other words used in the Constitution. School certificate was defined under four headings. It's only one of the headings that you know. The one of GCE and WASC and the teacher grade 2. The second definition, which is an alternative, is primary 6 school, first school leaving certificate with evidence of having worked anywhere at all, private or public. So it could be the yam seller under the bridge of Ibadan or the Akara Fryer on the highway to Ajakuta. Just say, I have worked for 10 years. then you bring primary six. That was what Masari, the one that is governor in Katsina where now, that was what he had at the time he was a speaker of Nigeria's House of Representatives. Below that, you now come to where you have the one I just talked about, primary six, is the third one. The second one is evidence of having been in any school that could have conducted the exam. So if you're a school dropout, whether you drop out in class one or class two, if you can bring evidence that you were once in a Hope Rising Secondary School, that is qualification by that definition. The third definition is the one of primary six. Then the worst one, the last one, is any qualification that is acceptable to INEC. Meaning that if INEC accepts your form of nomination and they stamp it, responsibility moves away from you permanently, whether as candidate or as a elected person in terms of qualification, because INEC should not be the one to answer to why they accepted you. Once they have accepted you, you have satisfied the requirement for educational qualification. So all the lawyers in Nigeria who have been telling you that if you don't have a school certificate or you don't have this or that, you can't, they are either ignorant or dishonest. There's no educational requirement for holding any office in Nigeria, including the presidency of Nigeria. That is in black and white the meaning assigned to school certificate. So when you take it through all of these sections we talked about, you then go to the exclusive list to see that it is because the refineries are on that exclusive list that it becomes the business of the federal government only, which can then destroy the four refineries, license them, go to monopoly, lock out everybody else, and then you don't have it. If nothing happens to that constitution, nothing will improve in security, nothing will improve in infrastructure, nothing will improve in the fight against corruption. That constitution, for every single thing we've listed so far, that constitution must go down before you can get relief. So if you don't want to pay the labor movement people that go around asking for more salary for themselves, when the capacity for refining petroleum products is locked away by that exclusive list, electricity we don't have. We're discussing 5,000 megawatts for 200 million people. The only reason why we have only 5,000 megawatts is that electricity transmission and generation is locked away into exclusive, only the federal government can. So as it is for refinery, so it is for electricity generation and transmission, so it is for the issues of law and order, issues of security, more importantly, arms and ammunition, and that's why the states cannot set up agencies that will carry guns. Are you going to confront people with sophisticated weapons without gun? And the governors are called chief executive officers. So everybody who goes to swear to defend and uphold that constitution is the enemy we are looking for. They are the ones sustaining this evil. If we don't take down that constitution, what we are seeing now will be a child's play. And it can only get worse. And so all of those who are suffering from it, whether you suffer from quota system, or you suffer from the killings happening in the middle belt coming down south, or you suffer from the assets that are seized, oil and gas in the Niger Delta, or bitumen, or Fondo, or limestone, all of those things confiscated by the instrumentality of that constitution through that exclusive list. If you want them back, if you want to see an end to corruption, if you want to see an end to impunity, if you want a future that will be better than this madness we are living in, you must come forward now to take a position in this contestation between truth and falsehood. Truth is that we didn't make the constitution. Falsehood is that we made the constitution. Between darkness and light. Light is where we take back our sovereignty and work out how we live together by ourselves in self-determination. Darkness is where we are corralled into this union of death that now belongs exclusively to the Fulani. If you are from this alliance territory and you are not taking a position, whether you are in the church or you are in the media, or you join them in all this type of dubious arguments they put forward all the time, calling terror bandit, you better come forward now because the young people are listening. They are taking note. They are looking at what you are doing. Are you on the side of this constitution or are you on the side of taking it down? If you're on the side of this constitution, you are going to be in trouble sooner than you can imagine in the hands of those who have been at the receiving end of the fraud Nigeria has become against them.